Good morning, and thank you for joining us as we commemorate International Women's Day. I'm your host, historian Edna Friedberg. Muriel Gardiner has been called the most thrilling person you've never heard of. I learned about her story through my colleague, historian Lindsay MacNeill. Good morning, Lindsay.
Good morning, Edna. Thanks for having me.
We're always glad to have you back. And I'm so happy to have you here today to tell us about Muriel and the people who credit her with saving their lives during the Holocaust. Viewers, please add your questions for Lindsay in the comment section, and we'll get to as many of them during the course of the live show as we are able. So, Lindsay, nothing in Muriel's background suggested that she would one day become a rescuer in 1930s Europe. Who was this woman? Where did she come from?
Right. So Muriel had a really interesting childhood, but not one that you would think would lead to her to live a clandestine or dangerous life. Here you can see her as a very cute and quite fancy baby. Muriel was born in 1901 into a family that ran a meatpacking empire. Her childhood home in Chicago took up a full city block, including the gardens. And at age 11, she became a multimillionaire when her father, Edward, who you can see here, unfortunately passed away from kidney disease. She inherited what is today essentially $100 million. Her mother, Helen, became one of the wealthiest women in the world at this time, inheriting money from her husband, but also from her own family. So Muriel grew up in a life of luxury, right? She could have become very spoiled, very sheltered, but she had a housekeeper named Nellie, who was an Irish immigrant, and a nanny named Molly, who really tried to teach her about how people lived in other circumstances, what life was like for most Americans. And Muriel really took this to heart. Decades later, she told a Washington Post reporter that by the age of 8 or 9, she was already really interested in injustice around her and even repelled by the luxury in her own home. And you can really tell that this was something Muriel was grappling with, because in her memoir, she talks about doing things like sleeping on the floor or taking cold showers, clearly trying to make sense of her role in the world and understand what other people went through.
So she was a child with an acute social conscience, very aware of haves and have-nots. But how did these childhood interests and passions blossom after Muriel left for college and then beyond?
So Muriel went to Wellesley College at the age of 17. Here you can see a photograph from her at this time. This was right around the end of World War I. And Muriel got interested in social justice things, politics. And she led a committee that answered letters from people who were suffering from the war, malnutrition, poverty, and she personally used her wealth to help one Bavarian woman who was struggling to feed her children. So then Muriel goes from Wellesley on to Oxford, where she eventually becomes interested in psychoanalysis. And for someone interested in psychoanalysis, there was really only one man you wanted to work with, Sigmund Freud, and only one city you wanted to live in, Vienna, Austria. So Muriel moves to Vienna in 1926, hoping to become a patient of Freud's.
And Vienna is really the place where her ideas shift into action. Give us a sense, please, of Muriel's life in Vienna in the 1920s and the early mid-1930s.
So when Muriel goes to Vienna, she is, again, hoping to work with Freud. This doesn't really work out, but she does get involved with other psychoanalysts. She decides that she's going to attend medical school at the University of Vienna. She also, while she's there, is interested in Austrian politics. Vienna was a really interesting place in the 1920s. The city government was run by the Austrian Social Democratic Party, which was a large working class party that was essentially experimenting with new types of housing projects, social help programs, cultural activities for people who were living in poverty and for the working class. And Muriel thinks this is really fascinating, really interesting. She starts to get really interested in the Austrian Social Democratic movement. She also marries, has a daughter named Connie, and divorces in this time period.
So really has jumped in headfirst into her adoptive country, made a life for herself. But for context, the political mood in Vienna shifted radically in the 1930s. And like a number of countries in Europe during this period, Austria took a hard turn toward authoritarian government. How did this shift affect Muriel and the circles in which she traveled.
So for Muriel's personal life, it's okay. She can attend medical school. She can raise her daughter. Things can continue on that front. But what really changes is politics and Muriel's involvement in them, because she starts to see the Austrian government crack down on the social democratic movement that she'd been so interested in. Eventually, the party is completely banned and has to go underground. And this is when Muriel really steps up her involvement. She starts to become part of a clandestine underground movement, working as a courier, a safe house, a contact using the code name Mary. So people in the socialist movement didn't know that she was Muriel Gardiner, medical student and heiress. They just knew that she was an American and that her name was Mary, her contact name at least. And Muriel particularly starts to use her cottage in the Vienna woods, which you can see a photograph of here, as well as her apartment as a safe place for members of this movement to stay overnight, to meet, to make plans. And one of the people who stays there is a man named Joel Buttinger, who had become a leader within the Austrian underground socialist movement. And he and Muriel actually fall in love. Here you can see a photograph of them as a couple. Because they really had, while very different backgrounds, Joe grew up in poverty in Germany and Austria, they had shared values, right? They were both really committed to helping others.
Lindsay, I'd like to pause for a moment to acknowledge viewers who are watching from around the country and around the world. Good morning to you in Annapolis, Maryland, Houston, Texas, Albuquerque, New Mexico, and Merced, California, as well as those joining us from abroad, including viewers in Portugal, the United Kingdom, Canada, and Australia. We're really glad you're with us, whatever time zone you are in. So she has this life, this political involvement, a loving partner, Joe, but there was grave danger lurking in the background. Adolf Hitler had his sights set on Austria, a neighboring German-speaking country, and many Germans and Austrians wanted the two nations to be formally united. In March 1938, the Nazis made their move, and the Austrian chancellor resigned under pressure on March 11th, and the Nazi takeover was almost immediate. For context and to really give a sense of what the feeling and mood was at that time, let's hear from a Jewish woman who lived in Austria at the time named Helene Menzel Reeves describe what this terrifying turning point was like for the almost 200,000 Jews living in the country at the time.
Hitler marched in. It was like the clouds, like the whole world would fall on top of you. Within hours, you heard screaming in the street, marching and marching, swastika and swastika. Heil Hitler, Heil Hitler, even when the windows were closed, even when they had stopped marching or singing, you still had the feeling, you hear it in your voice suddenly. You were afraid to go out into the street. You were afraid to stay home. You were afraid to go into your house.
So Helene really captures how terrifying a moment this was for Jews and for anti-Nazis. We saw in that video propaganda images, marches, the public displays of the Nazi takeover. But what we didn't see is the violence and the terror that was also taking place in the streets of Austria at this time, in the streets of Vienna, where Jews were attacked and publicly humiliated, and as she said, scared to leave their homes.
Yeah, a moment of total fear, vulnerability, panic, and violence. And this is swirling around for Muriel, even if she wasn't a target of it. So as she witnessed this descent and deterioration in Austria, how did her political activities shift?
So the situation in Austria really changed almost immediately. And Muriel's wealth, her American citizenship, her courage, and her generosity, they'd been assets before, but now they become even more important. And this is because the members of her political network, as well as Jews and others, are desperate. And they're desperate to flee Austria. You have people really racing to the borders, trying to get there before they're closed, before the Nazi takeover is complete. And then you have others who are trying to go into hiding, trying to avoid falling into Nazi hands. For members of political parties, Nazi opponents, anti-Nazis, they know what happened in Germany in 1933. They know how the Nazis targeted political opponents and sent them to concentration camps. So for people like Joe and his colleagues, this is desperate. And Muriel first sends Joe and Connie abroad, safe to safety in Switzerland and beyond. And she could have left, but she doesn't. She decides that she is going to stay. Here you can see Muriel and Connie around this time skiing. That she decides she's not going to go, right? She's not going to go with them to Switzerland. She's going to stay in Vienna, and she is going to try to help. And there are lots of people who are turning to her because she has the resources and is willing to help them get out.
So let's get a little more specific about this help. What kind of work and secret work did Muriel do to help not only political opponents flee Nazi Austria, but also Jewish Austrians? How did she help them to reach safety or to be protected?
So the most important thing you could really get in this time period was passports and visas. You had to find a way to leave the country. And so you had tens of thousands of Austrian Jews who almost immediately start to line up outside of embassies. Here you can see them lined up outside a police station trying to get things they need for their passports. They're trying to get on wait lists, trying to emigrate. But the anti-Nazi opponents can't really get in those lines necessarily. Many of them are wanted by the Gestapo, by the Nazis, and they can't just show up and say, oh, here I am, right here, I'm getting my paperwork. They have to find another way out. And what they needed were false papers. And what that means is they needed passports that had their picture, but not their name. And in order to do this, you have to first, of course, take your picture, and then you have to get it to the people who make the false papers and then pick up your false papers. And that's where Muriel really comes in for a lot of people. She's the go-between here. She's taking photographs of anti-Nazis and their families. She's bringing back passports that then allow people to leave. And she's doing this because she buys a corset even to like hide the papers so that if she's searched, no one's going to find them. And she does all sorts of almost like spy movie-like maneuvers in order to not get caught in this process. She is like ducking into churches in one door and ducking out another, taking a taxi, stopping for a leisurely coffee to try to throw anyone off her tail. She's doing all sorts of things. And she's doing this not just because she's afraid, which she is, but she's doing it because she knows how important these papers are. She knows that each of them represents someone's chance to get out and to live.
And just how precarious the people that she cares about, that their situation is. When you're talking about how critical a passport or an exit visa or a transit visa could be, it reminds me of a quote from an American journalist, a prominent American journalist at the time, Dorothy Thompson, who we can see here in a photograph from 1939. Dorothy Thompson was testifying before Congress. And in this period, she wrote, and I quote, "It is a fantastic commentary on the inhumanity of our times that for thousands and thousands of people, a piece of paper with a stamp on it is the difference between life and death." And that just really, I think, sums up how central and life-saving these documents could be, right?
It absolutely does. It really encapsulates just how critical this paperwork is. It can sound boring, I think, like visas, passports, bureaucracy, but it was crucial for people. And we know this because on April 1st, for instance, the first transport left Vienna for Dachau, filled with political opponents, with Jews, with others. And these, here you can see three of those who were on this transport here in their prisoner uniforms in Dachau, with their badge showing their political opponents and their number as well. So this really was crucial.
And we're hearing from viewers who are really responding to the story of Muriel and her bravery in taking on this kind of risky work. A man named Michael writes that Muriel is a courageous woman with a conscience and strong determination to do right in the face of such evil. So Lindsay, let's connect Muriel's secret work to some of the people she tried to protect, people who were actually doubly at risk. Please tell us about a couple named Otto and Käthe Leichter.
So Otto and Käthe Leichter are really a power couple in the Austrian Social Democratic movement. That's how they meet. they have this shared passion. They marry and they have two sons, Heinz and Franz, who you can see here with their parents in the 1930s. And once the Austrian government bans the social democratic movement, the Leichters initially do flee. They leave for Switzerland for a short time, but they're devoted to the cause and they return to Vienna, where they work in the underground network that Joe and Muriel are a part of. And Otto's even arrested at one point in the 1930s for his political activities. Here you can see his mugshot from that time period. Again, he's arrested because he is active in an underground political movement. And he's quite jaunty, I think. I like that he kept the hat on.
And Kata was very prominent in her own right. I know she was an advocate for working class women. So very, both of them well known. And this is not a good thing to be well known. No. The kind of work that you're talking about is happening before the Nazis annexed Austria. As we had said, there was an authoritarian government that had banned the Socialist Party, and they were both Jewish and politically risky, or considered politically dangerous once the annexation happened. So this was not a good place for them to be. How did Muriel intersect with them, and how did she help Otto to flee Vienna?
So Otto, as you said, he's pretty well known. He was a journalist. He'd been arrested before. People know who he is. So after the Nazi takeover, he's afraid. He doesn't want to necessarily be home. He's worried they're going to arrest him. So he pretty quickly decides that he is going to try to flee. First, he tries to go to Yugoslavia, but he's turned back at the border. And so he doesn't want to go home. Again, he's scared and he doesn't want to put his family in more danger. So he tries to find a place to go. And he says, aha, I'm going to Muriel Gardiner's house. Well, he knows her as Mary. So he goes to her apartment, and Muriel comes home one night, and there he is. He is sitting in her house kind of casually, you know, waiting for her. And she doesn't at first recognize him. She's a little caught off guard, of course, right? There's a strange man in her apartment at an odd time, terrifying time. He reminds her, though, no, we've met, right? Remember, I know Joe, I'm in this movement. And so she lets him stay. Spends one night there, a small act, I think, in this case, of help in Otto's journey, but really the beginning of their relationship. Because once Otto successfully manages to flee, he ends up in Paris, and he meets up with Joe eventually. So Muriel has contact with both Otto and Joe and other Austrian refugees who are in Paris. This allows her to serve as a go-between between Otto and Käthe, because Käthe has not fled. She was a little less famous. She had a lot of things she wanted to do at home. She wanted to make sure that her boys were safe, that her boys could immigrate. And she was worried because she had an older mother and she didn't want to just leave her behind in Vienna. So Muriel passes messages from Otto to Käthe, and she encourages Käthe at Otto's request to hurry up, to leave, to also flee.
But for all the reasons you describe, including I think many of us can relate to feeling responsible for an elderly parent, she does not go immediately. And what happens to her? What happens to his wife, Käthe Leichter?
So Käthe is arrested eventually. She had decided she was going to flee, but her plans are betrayed. She's taken into custody by the Gestapo and held there in prison in Vienna without charge. Eventually, she is charged with treason and sentenced to a sentence of a few months. But instead of releasing her at the time, she is actually instead sent to Ravensbrück concentration camp, which you can see photographs of here. We know from Käthe's fellow prisoners that she kept up her her spirits, that she continued to be active in the political scene and with her friends and colleagues. And tragically, though, in March of 1942, she is selected by Nazi officials and murdered with poison gas. And before she, at another facility, and before this, before she leaves, she says goodbye to one of her friends and passes on a message for Otto and her two sons. She says essentially to tell them that she loved them, that they were her greatest joy, that she felt so lucky to have had them in her life. And also she says to tell the party that if she could live her life Again, she would live it exactly the same way that she had lived it up until that point. Käthe Leichter was one of 65,000 Austrian Jews murdered in the Holocaust. Otto's parents, Samuel and Regina Leichter, were also among those victims.
And a viewer named Joan Marie writes that how sad that love for your family can mean a death sentence. In this case, Käthe's dedication to her mother, to her sons, but also we see to her ideology, to her party, to her beliefs that the world could be a more just place. And in fact, to this day, there is an award given by the Austrian government in Käthe Leichter's name. So this loss must have been incredibly wrenching and difficult for Otto to know that he got out by the skin of his teeth, but his wife did not. What became of him and of their two young sons?
Otto was devastated by this. He was devastated that Käthe was in prison. He and his sons tried to be in touch with her as much as they could, writing her letters. Eventually, World War II begins, and Otto and Joe, who are again both in Paris, are initially interned as enemy aliens. So this was sort of doubly painful, I think, for the boys, right? Both of their parents were in prison at one point. Luckily, Otto is quickly released, and he and his sons, with Muriel's help, managed to immigrate to the United States. Muriel also pays for the boys through a special fund she set up to attend school once they're in America. Otto dies after having spent years in the United States as a foreign correspondent, active in the Austrian immigrant community in the 70s. And at the time, he and then Käthe are memorialized together on a plaque in Vienna.
So they were local heroes of the resistance. And Muriel Gardiner did, she was loyal to them. She took care of them, not only helping Otto to escape, but acting as a critical support for them as they built new lives. I do think, though, just hearing about what happened to Käthe reminds us that while some of the stories we're hearing of code names and corsets, they may sound thrilling, that, of course, there were really horrific risks and very real people in jeopardy. Muriel is credited with helping to rescue not only Otto Leichter, but hundreds of people. And we are seeing a photo of her here later in life. And we know that for every person who was able to escape, there were many more like Käthe Leichter who did not survive. So what about Muriel? Did she stay in Europe for the duration of the war? What happened for her next?
So Muriel actually manages to sort of wrap things up in Vienna eventually. You know, she'd lived there for more than a decade at this point. So she moves her whole family, her whole life, eventually out of Austria. She's worried because what she's doing is illegal. She's worried that she's going to get caught and that she's going to get in trouble. She eventually leaves, reunites with Joe in France, and eventually they emigrate to the United, or she doesn't emigrate, she comes home, but Joe emigrates to the United States, and they had sent Connie on ahead.
And she and Joe have gotten married at this point, so their family is safely in the United States. But once back home in the U.S., Muriel didn't forget those who were still stranded in German-occupied Europe. How did she turn her attention and energy next?
This is one of the things I think is so incredible about Muriel Gardiner, is that she didn't just react in one moment of crisis. She continued to keep her attention on those who needed her help. She signs numerous affidavits for people vouching for them to come to the United States. At one point, the U.S. government tells her, enough, right? You've signed enough. You can't take on any more. She recruits other people to sign affidavits. She really does whatever she can to help people who are trapped in Europe. She and Joe personally lobby First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt to get special visas for especially endangered people who are in France, in particular anti-Nazis who are also Jewish, who are stuck in German-occupied Europe at that point. So she's really trying everything she can to help refugees. And this continues. She and Joe also help found the Emergency Rescue Committee, which is now the International Rescue Committee, which helps refugees to this day. So this becomes her one of her causes, right? She's devoted to helping people who are in danger. Here you can see her with a bust of her husband, Joe, later in life as well. And after the war, Muriel and Joe are still not done. They send care packages to more than 100, about 100, excuse me, Austrian families who are suffering from malnutrition, poverty, and the effects of the war. So she continues her work.
kind of full circle. You had mentioned that as a college student after the First World War, she was helping people in need. And clearly this was a woman who couldn't sleep at night if she knew there were people in distress or fear or deprivation. We have a question, Lindsay. A viewer named Angela is asking, has Muriel written or did she write about her experiences during that time?
She did. She has a memoir called Codename Mary, which you can purchase through the Freud Museum in London. That's available there. They've reprinted it now because they did an exhibition on her in recent years. There is also a movie called Julia, which was based on a different book by someone else. And one of the characters is quite strikingly reminiscent of Muriel. She's played by Vanessa Redgrave. We don't know for sure that it's her, but lots of people thought it was. So if you want to learn more about Muriel, a great place to start is her memoir, Codename Mary. But there's also a film if you want to see Vanessa Redgrave.
Lindsay, I want to thank you so much for introducing us to this fascinating and courageous woman, Muriel Gardiner. We'd also like to thank her daughter, Connie Harvey, who gave us permission to share so many personal photographs today, and also acknowledge two of Muriel's grandchildren, Anne and Hal, who remembered their grandmother as nothing short of magical. She couldn't stand injustice, her grandchildren, Anne and Hal, told us. She cared about people immensely and intensely, and clearly that made a huge difference in so many people's lives. A viewer named Mary writes that Muriel was a wonderful woman with a special sense of humanity and justice, and she should be celebrated. Another viewer named Rebecca remarks that the world is filled with amazing and courageous people quietly going about the business of saving lives and righting wrongs. Think of this when you are feeling helpless or defeated about the state of humanity. And I couldn't agree more, Rebecca. That's why on International Women's Day, we wanted to share this story. We hope that it's inspiring to others and that we can acknowledge the bravery of women like Muriel Gardiner, like Kata Leichter, and so many others whose names we do not know. Let's return to Holocaust survivor Helene Menzel-Reeves, the Austrian Jewish woman we heard from earlier. She barely knew Muriel when Muriel offered to help. She secured paperwork that allowed Helene's fiancé to escape Austria, and the couple reunited in America. Thank you for watching. Let's hear from Helene.
Muriel Gardiner, we owe her everything, owe her our life. Without her, I would not be married, I would not have children, I would not have had grandchildren. She worked in the anti-Nazi movement. She endangered her life for years only to help people. I love her.